Penguin Random House Audio presents The Vanishing of Flight MH370, the true story of the hunt for the missing Malaysian plane. This is the author, Richard Quest. To my colleagues at CNN, both in front of and behind the cameras, without your collective efforts, this book would not have been possible. We truly did go all in to cover this story, and we will continue to do so wherever it goes. The introduction. Where's that plane? If there's one question I get asked most by CNN viewers these days, this is it. From politicians and CEOs to doormen and cab drivers, time and again they want to know, what happened to that plane? Where is it? Malaysia Airlines Flight MH370, with 239 people aboard, departed from Kuala Lumpur shortly after midnight on March 8, 2014, bound for Beijing, China, and has never been seen since. Despite the largest aviation search in history, virtually nothing was found of the aircraft in the wake of its disappearance. 16 months later, thousands of miles from the flight's path, a piece of an airplane's wing washed ashore on Reunion Island. Still, this bit of evidence and a flimsy trail of electronic satellite data are all we have to go on, plus a huge amount of speculation and confusion. The most difficult search ever undertaken in human history. When Australia's Prime Minister Tony Abbott uttered those words in April 2014, it was not just the usual hyperbole of a politician. What happened to MH370 has been described as a unique, unprecedented, and extraordinary mystery. Planes may crash, but they are not supposed to disappear without a trace. Earlier ocean crashes, such as Air France 447 or Air India 182, have demonstrated that wreckages can typically be located within hours. Today's airlines own the most modern aircraft, featuring up-to-date navigation technology. While regulations govern everything, from the number of hours a pilot can fly to the fire-resistant fabric used in the passenger seats. Despite the precautions, no one has been able to pinpoint the final resting place of MH370 and those on board. All the while we know that if you lose your iPhone, it can be traced within minutes. At the heart of this mystery remains the question of the cause of the plane's disappearance. Was it mechanical or was it criminal? Did someone deliberately take over the aircraft and set it on a course to the South Indian Ocean, intending to kill all on board? Would that someone turn out to be an unknown hijacker or terrorist, or could it have been one of the pilots? I've spent hours debating the possibilities of what might have happened to MH370 with those who declare what must have happened. Frequently, whenever I suggest that they keep an open mind, because unsatisfying though it is, we don't know, there is the inevitable, but surely, followed by a series of half-truths, myths, and rumours that have been allowed to enter the debate and fester. Do I have a view of what might have happened? I do, and I will share it. In doing so, I'm not blind to the obvious options, but prefer to keep an open mind on the eventual outcome. As will become clear in the chapters that follow, as a television journalist, I became frustrated and even angry with some of the pundits with whom I had to work, who were quite prepared to convict the pilots long before any evidence had been found. Instead, this book will stick to the facts as we know them. In the end, you will be left to make up your own mind about where you think the evidence leads. The disappearance of MH370 has been a serious failure for the multi-billion dollar aviation industry, revealing disturbing facts and behaviours that one of the most advanced aircraft in the world should vanish while an airline left hundreds of desperate families waiting for news of their loved ones is unpardonable. In response, airlines have rewritten their rules from top to bottom. An alphabet soup of international organizations responsible for air travel safety have held high-level meetings and set up task forces to look into ways to ensure planes are always tracked in real time. Even CEOs I spoke to were as astounded as the general public that planes were not always being tracked to a fine point of precision. Some of the changes did not come soon enough. As suspicion about MH370's pilots increased, discussions were held about a two-person-in-the-cockpit rule, stipulating that if one pilot temporarily leaves the cockpit, he or she should be replaced by a flight attendant. Yet the considerable amount of talk led to very little action. If such a change had been made, the crashing of Germanwings 9525, in which a rogue pilot deliberately flew his airliner into a mountain, possibly would not have happened. When all is said and done, MH370 boils down to one simple fact. For the first time since the Wright brothers first flew, this industry, which prided itself on a policy of safety first, is having to cope with the unthinkable. A plane disappeared. It's no wonder the head of the airline organization, IATA, Tony Tyler, decried, "A large commercial airliner going missing without a trace for so long is unprecedented in modern aviation, and it must not happen again." The fascination with MH370 goes deeper than an aviation story. International diplomatic and political issues have been raised too. More than 60% of the passengers on board the plane were Chinese citizens, and the Chinese government wasted little time in flexing its muscles on their behalf. The relatives of Chinese victims were put up in a Beijing hotel, where regular briefings were given by low-level Malaysian government and airline officials. These were acrimonious events, interrupted frequently by hysterical outbursts from distraught family members, frustrated at the lack of the information they were being given. The way the relatives were treated was shabby at best. Then there was the role of the Malaysian government itself. Were they a bunch of incompetents who had no idea what they were doing, doomed to make mistake after mistake? Or perhaps the truth was something more sinister, a cover-up for an erroneous military strike? Few people will deny that the first weeks of this crisis were not something of which the Malaysians can be proud. As the tensions rose across the South China Sea, the fate of MH370 rapidly became entwined in a diplomatic game of rail politic, mystery, intrigue, and failure. So why did I decide to write this book? To begin, there's my own personal relationship to this story. 16 days before MH370's disappearance, I met and flew with the plane's first officer, Farik Hamid, filming him for a segment on CNN. Immediately after the story of the plane's vanishing broke, I found that a three-hour flight with someone I'd met only once more than 2 weeks prior had now taken on a new importance, and everything about that trip was suddenly the focus of great attention. Conspiracy theorists had a field day. My Twitter account was inundated with comments suggesting that somehow CNN and I had known something was going to happen, or that we perhaps knew where the plane was. We didn't, and we don't. During that trip to Malaysia in February 2014, I'd also spent time with the chief executive of Malaysia Airlines, or MH as it's known by its IATA code. The airline was in deep financial trouble, well before MH370. Its business model was failing, and the carrier was being squeezed. On the one side are the Gulf 3 carriers, Emirates, Etihad and Qatar Airways, siphoning off the long-haul customers. On the other side is the low-cost airline Air Asia, also based in Kuala Lumpur. Nutcrackered in the middle, Malaysia Airlines found it impossible to be financially viable. In short, this proud airline, flying for more than half a century, had to find its role in the new world of air travel. Having just travelled to Malaysia to do a story on MH, I was familiar with the difficulties the company was facing and the actions being proposed by the CEO, Ahmed Jahari Yaha, AJ as he's known, to put things right. I spent several hours with AJ discussing his strategy for turning MH.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.